my flight nurse. She keeps me on travel. And then the ultimate hero here is our chauffeur rep, Alan. He's our pilot in charge. So we don't get to do any of this if Brad doesn't take us around and chauffeur us around point A to point B. So what we want to do today is just kind of do dealing with emergencies on the farm or the ranch, whether you guys are back at home working on your property, or if you guys are out on the range, if something's going on, if you have a horse accident or something, or your grandfather starts having chest pain, things that you can do until 911 comes to you. So just some quick first aid tips. This is not going to be all inclusive, as I have to do a little disclaimer. A lot of this is it's just going to be really down and dirty, quick little basic first aid tips to kind of get you, buy you a few minutes until you can get 911 to come help you, or you can get more people to come to your side. But that will just do just quick introductions of kind of our background, our experience, how we got from the hospital to where we are in the transport world. Nikki, can you start?
My name is Nikki. I actually went to school at Northwest College in Powell, Wyoming. I graduated with an associate's degree, and I got my first job here in Lander. I worked on med-surg for a year, a little over a year, and then went to the ICU and got some really good experience there. And then at that point, probably around 3.5 years or so, I ended up becoming a flight nurse, and then I learned more than I've ever known, and I've been a flight nurse for about 6.5 years.
Brad? Can't talk really loud.
Yeah. I went to school to fly helicopters. Started out crop dusting in California, did tours in the Grand Canyon, and then got on the Guardian. I started in Michigan for a year.
Medical Center on their ground service, and was fortunate enough to get back and hired on Guardian flight. Did fixed wing for 8 months, and then I got to come to the rotor about 4.5 years ago. So I'm on my 5th year of flying with the company. So kind of different perspectives that you're flying in instead of just driving to the incident. So kind of what we're talking about today are things like are remotely, or you guys are far enough away that there's a good chance you might have an interaction with the helicopter, and that's kind of what we wanted to do, is how we can partner together, how you guys can start the initial care, and then what we can do afterwards to kind of help you guys out. So a couple of the things we're going to review is chest pain, and we're looking at the emergencies that matter in minutes, things that can kill you in 10 to 15 minutes. So that's kind of what our focus is today, is some quick tips on chest pain, cardiac arrest, allergic reactions, and then if you have somebody who has low blood sugar, hypoglycemia, we'll kind of review those for medical. We're also going to review some of the common injuries that you guys will find on the farm and ranch, whether it's lacerations, amputations, things that you'll see from like PTOs, car accidents, UTVs, and horses. Horses are great for business for us, unfortunately. And then we're going to talk about the interaction with the 911 system, and how to activate us and what you can expect when EMS shows up. Do you want to take a break?
Yeah, I can chest pain. So the chest pain can be an indication of coronary and heart disease. Oftentimes it indicates an acute myocardial infarction, and that just means lack of blood flow to the heart. Or heart attack is a common term people use. Some symptoms for chest pain that could indicate a heart attack include discomfort in the center of the chest. You can have shoulder and arm or neck pain. Generally, if you have an injury, like if there's lack of blood flow somewhere or there's an organ that's not working correctly, you have radiation upwards. So like the heart, if there's an issue with the heart, oftentimes you'll get that radiation of pain up into the neck and the jaw and then down on the shoulder. Down this way. Some people have weird symptoms, like you can get like tingling, burning sensation in the arms. That's also one weird symptom. Women often have like GI upset, where you have, so severe stomach pain, so that there can be some other symptoms that are kind of weird, but so you can't always just trust that these are the only symptoms you're going to have. But anything abnormal, definitely make sure you pay attention to. And it's not just pain, it can be just discomfort. Like, it just doesn't feel right. It's not very comfortable. Shortness of breath, you can get where you're at rest, you're sitting down, and you can't breathe like normal. You feel like you're struggling to get that breath. Coughing is one of them. I haven't seen that a lot, but that can be an indication of some cardiac congestion, like the heart isn't pumping effectively. Fainting, syncope is sometimes what we call it in the medical field, where for whatever reason, maybe it's pain related, you can have a syncopal event where you've got lack of blood flow to the head because the heart isn't pumping as well, or just the pain in general can generate like a response that causes you to faint. Fatigue, you get kind of tired and you just can't do your normal day-to-day activities. You can't do your normal like walking from in and around the room, or even just, you know, across the field, like if you're in a field and you're trying to get like into the tractor or out of the tractor, or you're trying to deal with livestock, things like that. And then nausea, vomiting, any of those symptoms. Some of those symptoms are common with other things, like maybe you ate a bad sandwich or things like that, but these are some symptoms that are associated with chest pain. And then palpitations. You feel like your heart is pounding and you can feel it. Because normally at rest, like us sitting here, we shouldn't be able to feel our heart pounding. Sometimes, like if you have an adrenaline response, like you have to get up and move quickly, or like you're moving to catch something, or we can feel that palpitation. That's sometimes what's common with chest pain, but that it doesn't go away. And then it may be irregular. Sometimes that can be a symptom. Treatments are early recognition is key. So any of these symptoms, or if you have any history, like your family history, where your mom or your father have cardiac disease, things like that, and you have that kind of in the back of your mind, always be kind of aware of it. And if you have these symptoms, this is something to get checked out. And then time is muscle. The heart. This is one of the most emergent things for us during a transport, because the sooner we can get that vessel that is occluded, if there's like a blood clot or if there's plaque that's occluding that vessel that goes to certain parts of your heart, if we're able to get that open, then the less damage to the heart occurs. So the sooner you respond, the sooner you activate 911, the sooner you recognize that you're having a heart attack or that you're having symptoms, is going to get you a better outcome in general. And then whatever you're doing, stop activity, loosen your clothing, try not to exert yourself, because that's going to increase your demand on your heart that is already in a stress situation. And then anytime, usually, like if we have a patient that we're responding to, like on a farm, then we always want to protect them from injury. So making sure that if like you're with a family member and you've activated 911, you call 911 and then you have them rest and you take care of them. And make sure that they are not in like a ditch where there's water, or make sure that they didn't fall into a certain area where they could potentially become like hypothermic. Or
get them to stop operating the tractor.
Yes, stop. Have them stop driving the tractor. And then some of the common medications that we use are aspirin, like 324 milligrams or 4 of the baby aspirins is a common dose that we use. And then chew them and swallow.
So a lot of people think they just take the aspirin, the one adult aspirin, they'll just swallow it. But if you look at your aspirin, there's a coating on it. It actually kind of slow release. We want this aspirin into your bloodstream as fast as we can. So that's why we're making the patients chew it. Baby aspirin usually has some flavor to it. It'll taste better, but no matter what, it's going to be bitter and discomfort. It's gross, but that helps get the aspirin into the bloodstream. But you have to be careful. Some people have allergies to aspirins and whatnot. So again, this is something that you know, you can call your primary care while you're waiting to say, hey, can I go ahead and give this to my dad, or can I give this to mom? And they'll probably tell you it's okay to go ahead and do it, but if we get there, that's probably one of the first things we're going to do is start giving some aspirin and whatnot. Because it makes your blood slippery, so things keep on moving by instead of sticking and clumping and making that clot bigger.
And then our goal is to have rapid and safe transport to a cardiac cath lab center where they can perform PCI, as we call it, percutaneous cardiac intervention, so that they can stent the vessel open and allow blood flow to then go back to reperfuse that area of the heart that's struggling.
So one of the things that's really helpful from you guys' perspective, if you know what time the chest pain started, the clock starts ticking. They have only so many minutes to get to a cath lab to actually be able to do the cath versus doing certain drugs. So we kind of weigh how long it's going to take us to get them to Wyoming Medical Center or to Billings or to Denver, someplace that could actually do these cath labs. And so they kind of start judging, well, do we want to give them the medications that breaks up the clots, or do we want to just get them there as fast as we can and go straight for the shooting up the little stents and opening the vessel up manually?
So Lander has a cath lab now. It's the mobile cath unit. They have done a few procedures at this point. I don't know how many. I don't know what the number is, but they've had some success. I think Dr. Corbel is the one that's doing the procedures. And at this point, it's always good to activate the 911 system, because then they can figure out where the best place for you to go at that point is, depending on the healthcare providers and what's available.
Any questions on chest pain? Again, not everything is cardiac related, but the cardiac is probably the most, the biggest emergency. So we kind of treat it as cardiac until proven otherwise. So if the pain starts and when they sit down and rest and the pain does not go away, you need to start considering trying to get them some type of medical attention, whether you call us or at least get them to go to town. So, because like I said, some of our grandparents are pretty stubborn and don't want to go.
I'm fine.
So cardiac arrest can be sometimes what, when your chest pain can progress to the part where the blood clot totally occludes the coronary vessel, and you could go into cardiac arrest. The symptoms are pretty basic. They become unresponsive. They start having abnormal breathing or no breathing at all, and you will not be able to detect a pulse. The new standards for American Heart Association, they've actually changed it around. It used to be that we opened the airway, checked the breathing, and went right to compressions. Now we're going right to compressions. If their breathing is abnormal and they're not talking to you or won't respond, we start doing compressions immediately. So, like I said, come up and you come and check. Hey, Dad, are you okay? Wake up. If he's not, look to see if he's breathing normal. Kind of open the head just a little bit, and you go right to the center of the chest. And just start doing compressions. Does anybody know how fast you want to do compressions?
To the song.
Okay.
You want to the song.
That one song.
Staying Alive.
Yeah, Staying Alive.
Yeah, another one. Yeah, Staying Alive is a good one. But basically, you want to do 100 compressions to 120 compressions per minute. So it's a pretty fast. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And you just keep going until you come up to 30 compressions, and then you can give a ventilation. If this is a stranger and you come up upon them and you don't know who this person is, you can just continue to do CPR. Sorry, it's time to do a meeting. You can just keep on doing CPR. You don't even have to give them a breath. If you're comfortable giving a breath, you can use your mask and you can ventilate them. You can tip the head back, open the airway, pinch the nose, and you can ventilate them.
Or these masks that we gave you, these are a perfect thing that you can use as a barrier, because you're able to kind of seal around the mouth and it gives you that vent port that you can place on the patient.
And if you have somebody that's with you, you know, if your sister's with you and you guys are doing this, you guys can switch every 2 minutes so you don't get fatigued. Because the ideal is you want those compressions to be very effective, and you just keep going until you can go no more. So until you can get some more people to help you.
So this is just a very simple chakra around the ears. And then this will go over the mouth, and then you put your mouth over that. That's how that works. This is a one-time use. Do not reuse these.
But it's kind of nice, because then you don't have to worry about getting the germs and that might be out there right now.
And just be cautious, too, if you're high risk for, you know, getting COVID, and you don't know their COVID status, it may just be better off not doing ventilations.
Just do
to
CPR.
Protect yourself. Yeah. Just go straight to CPR.
Basic same concepts if you guys had a child or a pediatric again. You still do 30 compressions, and you're still doing the 100 to 120 beats per minute. So pretty similar now. So now you don't have to know all the different age groups, so they've really simplified it. The next medical that you guys might encounter is a stroke. It's a cerebral vascular accident, but the short version is a stroke. You get a blood clot into the brain, one of the blood vessels that occludes, and then your brain is not getting blood. And some of the symptoms you guys have heard about, you get the facial drooping, that one side of the face kind of droops, or they can't, you know, a half a smile. The eyelids will droop a little bit. The other thing you'll notice is they may not be able to speak. They either slurred speech or they can't speak at all. And it depends on what center of the brain's affected and how your speech is going to be affected. You might also see that they're going to get one-sided weakness. So the right side of their body may not work, but the left side is working fine. So those things you're kind of looking for is those unilateral weaknesses. And then time. So there's an acronym that they use called FAST. So it goes back to the facial drooping. Arm drift, if you tell them to hold their arms up, palms up, and if it falls down or one falls, that's usually kind of an indicator that they're having some type of a stroke symptoms. If they can't hold that arm up or it just slowly starts to fall down and the other one stays up, that's an indicator.
That, on that note, though, also if you have rotator issues, sometimes that can be a difficult test to perform, so that's something good to just be aware of.
But if you have it in conjunction with facial drooping, that's
yes.
Probably pretty key.
Yep.
And then just call right away. This is one of those, again, that there's a certain time frame that used to be 3 hours to get them to a neurologist and they could do the clot busting. Now they're able to go up to 6 hours and they can actually go in through radiology services, go up through your groin, go all the way threaded up, and they can actually start removing those clots, or they can put the clot busters right on the clot in the brain. It's pretty amazing what they can do now. Not everybody's going to have these total disability of strokes like we used to 10 years ago. So the big thing is call 911 early. Be prepared for these patients to be sick to their stomach. They can usually get pretty nauseous. They'll vomit, so you want to protect the airway. Have them sitting up or turn them on their side. And you can just put the patient on their left or right side and put their arm out. You can just put it out to the side, and that will help protect their head too.
Bend their knees so that they stay in that position.
Yep.
We turned our mannequin over.
He fell over.
There we go.
So you can do what's called a rescue recovery position, and that will help protect the airway. Think about keeping their head up even a little bit. If you think about it, the head is kind of like had an assault, like somebody's, if you hit your skin, you get a bruise and it swells. Well, when the brain is under assault, it kind of starts to swell too. So if you keep sitting upright a little bit, that lets gravity kind of help pull swelling down. So it's okay to keep them up or kind of in this elevated. Big takeaway is calling 911 early so we can get these medications on board and get them to a neurologist. We don't have one in Fremont County at all, so they have to go to Casper or to Idaho, Montana, Colorado, Utah. That's where we're going to have to ship these patients out to. So that's just kind of one of the disadvantages for living in a small community. So Casper gets all of them. Any questions on the stroke stuff as far as recognizing the symptoms? So if you can remember the FAST, facial, arm drift, speech, and then time, that'll help you guys be aware of the stroke indicators. As far as doing anything for them, there's really nothing you can give them to help make this any better. It's just, you need to activate right away.
And the point of activating is you're there with whoever is having this episode, either chest pain or a stroke, and then you enduring to watch them while help is on the way, and they're bringing a truck full of things that they can use if whoever's having chest pain or the stroke symptoms starts to deteriorate. So it doesn't always help when you move to jump in the car and head to the hospital because something can happen in route where they stop breathing, they go into a dysrhythmia where their heart stops and you can't do anything. So it's better for you to stay next to them and wait for EMS to arrive.
If you guys are the victims of the stroke yourself, if you have any of these symptoms, even if you just dial 911 and it's an open line and you're able to dial, at least that phone is going in for coordinates and they'll send an officer out to investigate, and that's one way of activating. Even if you can just get 911 out and there's nothing on the other end, you know, just keep dialing that and dispatch will send somebody to investigate. So.
Next one, allergic reactions.
And then you do the following one.
So allergics, again, we're just going to kind of talk about the severe one, because if anybody's ever had allergies to wool or certain medications, bee stings, you get kind of an irritant. Your skin might get red, you might get a hive, but you don't usually have any troubles with your breathing. It doesn't feel like somebody's constricting your throat or choking you down. The severe reactions go to the point within a matter of minutes, and somebody will actually start having troubles breathing, or it feels like their throat is swelling. Their tongues can swell, and they get a lot of facial edema, and they're literally are going to be choking on their own tongue, or their airway is constricting. So a lot of these patients already know that they're allergic to some type of medication, especially if they have a severe reaction to bees. They'll have what's called an EpiPen. You guys ever heard of that? It looks like a great big magic marker, but it's actually built in with a medication and a needle on the end, and then you just pop the top off of it, prime it, and you just stick it right through the clothing and everything right into their thigh. And you just hold it there for 30 seconds and allow that medication to go into the thigh and absorb it to the blood system. It's a rescue, but it will actually, the epinephrine will help reduce the swelling so they can breathe again. The other thing you can think about is
those patients who have severe reactions can relapse. The epinephrine may not be able to, it will deteriorate, or the efficacy will wear off before the allergen does. So they may relapse. So again, if they have a severe reaction, they should be seen by our medical care provider because they may need a second or third dosing. If you have Benadryl on board, you can give them 25, 50 milligrams of Benadryl and just kind of help wean them over until they get to medical help. So if you're building like a little kit to go out for Roundup or something like that, you can just throw a couple, you can throw some aspirin in, throw some Benadryl in, and they'll take care of most of your common medical emergencies, at least until you get some help. And again, whenever you use that pen, they need to seek medical attention. Nothing else, they need to get it renewed. They're going to get a new prescription. The other one was a hypoglycemia. Usually if you guys are
or your neighbors in that, or even a church group, a lot of times you know kind of who's diabetic and who's not. Just kind of be watching them, especially if it's a busy day, branding or whatever, they might be overexerting, and you just need to kind of watch and make sure that they've had time to eat something. So make breaks, but just get to know who's in your group and do they have any medical history that you should be aware of so that you can kind of do a little buddy check on.
And if they're aware enough, you can always try and get them to eat something. If they pass out, then they need emergency medical care. So you need to be activating 911 because they're going to have to be giving them something, like an injection into their thigh that allows the liver to release glucose. The liver does store a certain amount of glucose, but you have to have a certain medication to tell the body to release that in an emergency. So sometimes the blood sugar will get low enough. Sometimes honey will work if you have someone that's kind of like making that like mouthing and tonguing things, but they can't talk to you, okay, then you get a packet of honey or something that's kind of syrupy that will absorb through the oral mucosa, and that sometimes helps. So
diet drinks, if you try to give your buddy like a soda that's a diet drink, those aren't very effective for reversing the low blood sugar. So straight, which works kind of fast term, but again, you're gonna want to find them like a peanut butter sandwich to follow it up so you got some good carbohydrates so that that way they can start getting kind of recovery. And then some of them may have like little tablets. They look like little hard candies that are full of sugar, or they may carry a pocket full of hard candies. Again, it's just something you can get them to kind of get going. So again, know your buddies, know your family, and they may have something in their kit. Just know where it is so that you can just go grab it for them. Like your EpiPens, a lot of times people have them in their lunch boxes, or they'll have them in like a glove box, but they'll always have them somewhere close to them.
And if you know someone is diabetic, it's always good to kind of have that check system. Like you know they're out in the field working, and maybe just kind of check on them every once in a while, because oftentimes they're not able to tell you they're having a low blood sugar. So that's just something to be mindful of.
Any questions on so far? I mean, we're kind of hitting them hard and fast.
So the fun part is I like doing the trauma. That's more my flavor here. Because you can see it. It's easy. It's like somebody's bleeding. You stick your finger on it and plug the hole. It's a very simple concept. So things that we're going to actually kind of practice a little bit with and kind of go through with like the tourniquet and how to stop the bleeding is we'll look at treating your lacerations, avulsions. You hit somebody that hits a windshield and pulls their scalp back, how to kind of treat the avulsions. Amputations, fractures, we'll kind of just do some basic first aid for that. Discussion about head, neck, backs, burns. That's kind of a hot topic here lately with the recent car crash that was out west of town. And then we're just going to kind of go over the goals, but the one thing about trauma that's pretty cool is they all pretty much have a common goal. Stop the bleeding. Don't do any more harm to them. And then whatever injury, you splint the joint above the injury and the joint below it. It's a pretty simple concept. So if their back hurts, you splint the whole thing. If it's just a lower leg, then we're going to do, you know, from the knee down to the ankle, we'll splint it. So pretty simple concept. The big thing is we want to make sure the patient stays warm. There's kind of a misnomer that if they get cold, they won't bleed as much blood, and that's actually going to save their life. Cold weather actually affects your clotting factor and actually makes it so you can't clot. So when you do warm up, you're going to bleed even more. So that's kind of one thing. Even in the summertime, we want to keep them warm. If you've got the air conditioner just blasting away because you're hot, you need to kind of probably turn it off to keep your victim warm. So, and then the surface you're on, think about if we were laying on this floor for an extended time, you guys would get extremely cold. So again, we want to protect those barriers in between kind of keep warm. So things that you can look at, that you can make your own first aid kits, is just looking at your own clothing. Bandages, dressings, they can be bandanas, they can be your shirts, they can be the commercial first aid kits. If you have a simple bandana that's more colorful than this, you can do so many different things with them. It's pretty awesome. You can make soft splints out of them. You can do dressings. You can get pretty creative.
You want to splint me?
Sure.
she say that through a barbed wire fence came down and Kate, you know, stepping through for some reason, Kate ripped her arm open. If you just stop and put something on it and then put your fingers right in that laceration, put really strong pressure, I mean, you're not just doing baby touch. You're getting in there and you're pushing hard and holding it for, me have to hold it for a couple minutes. But it's not just a light touch. You're being firm about it. You get the good direct pressure, okay? So, you've probably heard all this before too, but it's a nice firm pressure. And it depends how deep it goes too, because there's arteries that are going to be spurting. Like they mimic the heartbeat, so it's like, so, and then there's veins which ooze a little bit. There's a difference in the vessels in the arms. You may have a variation of that.
So I was using my hands to put direct pressure on the dressing. You can actually use the knot on your bandana to give the same type of pressure that you just got done doing. So push down tight and then come back around and do another knot. And you just keep building the knots up the top. I ran out of tail now because I got carried away. But those knots will actually create direct pressure in lieu of your hands. So if you need to help get them moved, or you need to get the horses kind of settled down for a minute, you can always use a dressing, a pressure dressing. And then you're going to do the acronym ICE. You want to try to keep it cool, whether you use some ice packs from your lunchbox. Again, you just take your simple bandana. We want it a little bit elevated.
You can use a t-shirt or
you can even get a little fancy, keep your elbow from popping out the back side, and you've got to splint it. We were talking about the avulsions if she does the windshield. Like you do a do-rag, you know, you guys do the rags to go underneath your welding hats or something. And then the tail that's on the back side, you can actually pull a little pressure on it to give that pressure point. And then that will just kind of help protect if she had a scalping injury. Burns, if you had a really large surface area, this is great for doing like dressings over a really large surface. Like I said, you can cover a lot of surface area. She got burned across her chest. You can hold the dressing in. You can splint with it. If she injured her lower leg, you can actually self-splint. You can tie things together. We can tie her arm to herself. If for some reason her shoulder won't move, we can just tie it to herself so it's not bouncing around and you have to ride it out to, say, a landing zone. You can stabilize that shoulder long enough and then still get it back into an ATV or back onto a horse, and you can ride them to the closest extraction point. Like I said, I absolutely love my triangular bandages because I can even make halter tops if I had to. So, if I cut all the clothes off, then I can kind of like build it back more. But that's just any bandana that you have that you might have. You can get pretty creative. You can find these like at Walmart and their drugstore stuff and all the band-aids and stuff. Or you can just make your own. You can just take a piece of sheet and just cut a square and you can get pretty creative. You guys have vet wrap. In the medical field, we know it's Coban, but in the animal world, it's vet wrap. This stuff is next to have them in the coffee or something today. So vet wrap can do the same thing.
swelling from the trauma, the dressing is going to get tight and you need to be able to loosen it at some point. So yeah, Coban, it's nice because you can do self-adhering, but same thing, you can use it for tying things off too and just use those knots, you can just self-adhere.
It can be kind of a loose break tourniquet if you need it.
What else do you think, guys? Can you guys think of to use for dressings? Be creative here. What's in your backpack or what might be in your pickup or your vehicles that you guys can use for making a dressing or some type of a
kitchen strap or a jacket?
Jackets, yeah, very good. Yep. Ratchet straps you can use for securing to or securing rigid splint. So,
or a tourniquet.
So I don't have anything kind of rigid with me today, kind of improvising a little bit because there wasn't a lot left in this room. There's some broom handles back in the back. You could actually have, if we had to use, we could take and modify a broom handle for something rigid. You guys can use branches. I had an airplane crash years ago. You guys were way too young to remember it. You probably remember the cowboys that wrecked the airplane up on Beaver Rim. Years ago, one of them had an ankle injury, and the little tug he used for moving the aircraft around, they got creative and used that as a splint. So they actually put that to help mobilize the ankle. You can get these commercial things too. You can just go online and Google sand splint. When you first get them, they're floppy, but as soon as you put a little bit of grease in it, they are now rigid. And so, cool thing is that you can shape them to fit any kind of your injuries. So she had a lower arm fracture. Where do you think we want to splint? If her arm was broken here, where would you want to immobilize, make sure the joints, which joints do you want to stop moving?
Elbow.
Yeah, you do the elbow.
And above and below.
Yeah.
So you got your injury here, you got below, and then above.
Yep. If it was her femur that was fractured, what joints would we stop moving around?
Still put it around.
You could go full legs. You start with the hip all the way down, at least through the knee. Ankle, we could do kind of a stirrup and go for a splint that way. So these are nice. You can actually put them inside your backpack, and you can just make it as part of your frame. And then if you need it, you just kind of whip it out, and there it is. Or you put it in a saddle bag. Flat, it'll fit in there nice and flat. You can store it. Pretty malleable.
You can use, if you have a cardboard box, you can cut pieces of cardboard box.
If you have saddle blankets, this is a blanket, it's not a saddle blanket, but you can make soft splints out of it just by, usually, we'll use your forearm again, so I use your lap. But you can put a pillow, put her arm through it, and then you can just tape all the way around. Or you can take that saddle blanket, and you can come around the leg and tape it, and that'll be enough to kind of help stabilize that foot or the lower leg. It's not super great for the femur, but you get pretty creative. Lariats are stiff enough too that you can maybe tape them down, kind of squish them together, and you can use them on the back side of the leg to kind of help get some rigidity to help keep the arm from moving. So you get pretty creative. Again, the idea is you're going to just splint above and below. So,
could you use that as a seat bottle?
You could.
Okay. It's not ideal.
It's not ideal, but we could do it. So, just to show you what it would look like, if we had your handy coat band here. Again, just have your partner help you or your patient. You can even mallet so she's got a nice little comfort there for
fingers.
Fingers.
I didn't think it's your stuff.
down from the saddle and make some type of a splint with that as well. The only thing I caution is if you use branches, make sure you pat them so the little pieces of the edges don't poke in the skin and cause soft tissue injury there.
Do you like that? Oh, whatever. Kind of comfortable.
Any questions, guys? Gal?
I was about to do a cartwheel.
Or don't we? When should we move and when not to move the patient? My advice would be is that first ask the patient or check them out. Do they have any troubles moving? You know, if you tell them to move all of their fingers and toes and they can't do it, I would be cautious about moving them again. If they say that their arm is numb or they have numbness all through their lower extremities, I would be very cautious about moving it because that could indicate that they have some type of a back injury, that spinal cord has been affected. So if they have any troubles with motor or sensory, I would be very cautious about trying to like just get them back up on the horse and ride them out. If any time they have neck pain that it worsens whenever they try to move their neck or any movement makes it worse, again, I would kind of caution about moving those patients. Or just that the pain itself is so severe that they can't self-extricate. It's kind of like going back to wilderness EMS, where, again, if you guys are back up moving cows or something, you guys are kind of like doing wilderness EMS, really. And so sometimes, you know, your patients need to try to self-extricate or extract themselves. If this hurts too bad, then again, you guys might want to start calling in some resources that'll help you get them out of that scene. So that's when you guys can call and wait for 911. You have a lot of people will say, well, I can just throw them in the car and I can get there faster than the ambulance can. That's true, but some challenges that maybe you haven't really kind of thought about before you kind of make that judgment is, like I said, you are quite a ways from the road. Usually if you guys are up gathering cows or you're in the back 30 acres, 100 acres of the farm, you're gonna be some distance from actually improved roads, whether it's bouncing across two tracks or whatever. Again, it's going to make it a little challenging for you guys to kind of get out, and it may hurt the patient. Some of your areas, like if you are grazing around Jeffrey City, you guys are a long ways from any kind of help whatsoever. So just kind of think about some of the activities that you're around, and I would suggest that you guys have a pre-plan. If you're anywhere remote in that, find out who in your group has history of, you know, diabetes. Does anybody have allergies that we should be aware of? Maybe the bees or the wasps have just been pretty, you get in the fall where those hornets are really nasty. Those are some things that maybe you guys want to just kind of think about. It's like, does anybody need an EpiPen? Just kind of pre-plan. What would we do today if somebody fell off the horse and broke their foot or broke their leg? How are we going to get them out of here? What are we going to do? And just kind of plan and communicate that with each other. And then whatever happens from there, you'll find it's going to work out a lot smoother. And then you kind of know what you need to do.
And then making sure that whoever's in that group has the medications they need for the trip you're taking is also a good thing.
So things that EMS can bring to you is, one, we can bring anywhere from basic life support training, like our search and rescue members have basic first aid, wilderness training. They're great about getting back into the backcountry and helping get somebody out on the litter. We have special equipment, these litters that have a single tire and can literally roll you out or physically carry you out of an area for a certain distance. We have advanced providers that can start giving you IVs, they can start doing advanced airways. And then you get into your critical care teams where we kind of do basically an ICU ER approach to the patients. We can do a lot of things that a normal ambulance cannot do. The things that the ambulances will bring to you versus you throwing your loved one in the truck is we can bring you airway management. What if your sister stopped breathing while you're driving to town and you're still 30 minutes away from town? If she stops breathing, how are you going to resuscitate her while you're driving? You can't drive and ventilate at the same time. So you have to make the decision, do I keep on going and
knowing that she's going to have a brain injury, or do you need to stop and take care of her and then have somebody meet you? So you have, there's, you can't say that all situations you have to wait for EMS, but you can't say that all situations you don't need them. You really got to consider the risk versus the gain if you're just going to throw them in the vehicle and head for town. We can, if you have a chest injury, say you get a lung that's collapsed, you get kicked in the chest by a cow, get some broken ribs, and it punctures your lung, we can needle decompress your chest and actually make it so you can breathe again. Because that's another thing that within a few minutes you could die from. We can give you drugs that can be give you immediate life-threatening change. Anaphylaxis, we can give IV through drugs, we can defibrillate you, we can do all kinds of stuff that your normal vehicle is not going to have available. Plus we bring a team with us when we come to provide care. The other thing we have is sometimes the expertise to actually move them up and out of a situation. Out by yourself. This is a sinkhole that I had last time. The tractor is or the four-wheeler is a hole about 12 feet down. The patient is still trapped underneath that four-wheeler. For you to, as an individual, that might be a little challenging. Again, good time to call for help. So some of your terrain, again, is going to be a little challenging. So I just put out there, just kind of think about the way the risk versus gain when you say, I'm just when you do activate 911, the things that we can bring to you from the ground is we can get you a ground ambulance. We can get you the fire department that helps us give us more manpower. We can stabilize vehicles. We can do some low or high angle rescue. And we can also get search and rescue for more manpower too. Just by activating 911, it's not always about EMS. Search and rescue can help extract you and get you back home safely. And then the air ambulance, we actually have two choices in the county. We can do a helicopter or we can do a fixed wing. Our patients in Dubois with the airport, we can actually fly into the airport there and render aid. The ambulance can meet us there. So you have a couple different options when it comes to when you activate 911. So we have, and I would be dismissive if I didn't like do a little plug for our company. So we have five bases. Lander, Gillette, Worland, Riverton, Cody. We actually have two helicopters in Wyoming. We have one in Cody, and I have one here in Riverton. So Wyoming's pretty well covered by guarding for us. As we've said before, we have a pilot who has thousands of hours of flight time. I have my critical care nurse, and then you also have a critical care paramedic. Our minimum experience is going to be 3 years. And then we also have a medical doctor who is 24 hours available to us. So if we have any questions or oversight, he's on the phone available to us. We fly the A-Star. We like it. It's smaller than the 407 as far as configuration, but she's got a heftier performance. It's the only aircraft that's actually been on Mount Everest and been able to fly off of it. Granted, she was totally stripped off, but she's actually done it twice now. So up here in the Wind Rivers, we totally like using her because she's got great performance. Everything on a helicopter is based on weight and air density. The denser the air, the more we can fly, the less dense, it's a little more challenging. We also have night vision capabilities, and that's what the green photograph is. That's what it looks like to look through night vision. Goggles at night, everything's in green. Our landing zones, when you guys make that decision to activate, if you could give us an area about 100 feet by 100 feet, so you saw the cones out there, basically we try to go the length of the helicopter plus 40 feet, just to give us a little extra wiggle room. But 100 by 100 gives us, it's a nice square. So if you think about the size, half of a football field, something like that works great. You're just trying to figure out something visually. And then, our pilot always has the last choice of deciding if that's a good spot to land or if he's going to slide over and maybe try this meadow instead, just because the winds might be a little different. And we're looking for obstacles. So
So like the wire that's out here across that, we're always watching for that. So we'll circle above a couple times to make sure we can see everything. We do a high recon and then a low recon. And that's what we're looking for, is wires, trees, livestock. We don't want to scare livestock and push them into fences. Signposts or delineator posts that are on the highways. We don't want to put our tail rotor into that either. So, and then our surface. In the snow time, when we have a lot of snow, we can actually get a whiteout where we can't see the ground. It'll blind us, so we'll have to come back up. So, or we can get the reverse in the summer and get the brownouts from the dirt. So, we gave you our wool cart, and there's a quick reminder that 2 years from now, you may or may not remember this, and wool cart is just super handy to have. You put them in your glove box.
This is a picture of our dispatch center at South Jordan, Utah. They're the ones, that's where our dispatching comes from. But we work very closely with the Sheriff's Department, the ground EMS, we have search and rescue frequencies. We can talk to you about anybody in the state of Wyoming and the surrounding states if we have to. So, yeah, we're here to serve you guys and help any way we can. Do you have any questions or comments? Yes, ma'am.
So if you were going to Casper or Billings, how long usually would that take in the helicopter?
From Riverton to Casper, we're anywhere between 45 to 60 minutes. It kind of depends on if we get a headwind or not, but about 40 to 45 minutes is our average. Billings by helicopter is about an hour and 40 minutes. And again, it depends on headwinds or tailwinds. We've had some days that we can scoop.
The fixed wing is a little different if for whatever reason they can't fly because of the weather. The fixed wing can go from Lander to Casper or Riverton to Casper, usually in around 30 minutes or just under. You can also go to Billings in about 15 minutes.
So they're flying about 250 knots and we're flying about 140, 150 knots. But our advantage is we can go from seeing straight to the helipad at the hospital. These guys usually have to catch a ride from the airport into the hospital. So sometimes their speed will make up for that ground transport and vice versa. So,
and there are situations where we had to do the rotor ramification down off of the scene, but they can't get to the facility or to an area where they can receive a continuation of care. So then they'll hand off to us and then we can take them, like on the fixed wing. I fly over them.
Yeah, so we have, like, the helicopters have minimums. We have to be able to see 3 statute miles in front of us, and we have to have at least 1,500-foot ceilings, because they don't want to scud running and take a chance of running into power lines or anything like that. So our pilots say that we fly, it's boring to fly for medevacs because we keep it so flat and straight, and that's for the safety of the patients and the crew. We don't do anything fancy. There's no barrels or anything like that. It's flat and even. Safe and steady. Yes?
So how many patients do you usually get each day?
It varies. Fixed wings tend to run a little more, so yeah, a couple a week. Again, for critical care, so if the hospital is able to do the treatment, then luckily they won't be transferred out. So we average, you know, anywhere from 2 to 3 flights a week. Depends on the year or time of the year. So we have a lot of people that are down south right now, so that changes kind of our population dynamics. We have a lot of people that are not moving around right now. They're not traveling because of the COVID, so we don't see as many of the traffic incidents, kind of what we see. Summertime, we see a lot of travel, a lot of tourists coming through, not knowing their livestock. They don't stay away from buffaloes or whatever, or the grizzlies. Then people are just more active in the summer, and so you have a little more tendency if somebody slips or falls or something. So, thank you.
Great questions.
We have a couple half ball caps if you guys want a hat. We have a booth over in the other building that has some more swag. If you guys like some more goodies, you're welcome to go over there and load up, get some goodies. We really appreciate your time, and thank you. You guys have any suggestions?